Welcome to TMS Software TV. Today, I would like to give you a hands-on introduction to the new components, or some of the new components, in VCL UI Pack version 13. In particular, I'm going to focus on the new TAdvFrameView, which allows you to create a list of frames, kind of like a list box. However, you can specify the amount of rows and columns for the formatting. And as you can see here on the slide, it offers a responsive option, meaning that you will always keep track of all the frames inside of your list box, and the number of rows and columns is changed dynamically. Second, we have the TAdvToggleSwitch, a modern control to visualize Boolean values true and false. There are two options in particular, the round design, which is very much known from the Apple iPhone and iPad, and then the rectangular option, and also with shadows and no shadows. And best of all, this control can be integrated into your grid, as shown here as well. The TAdvStringGrid offers support for this new toggle switch out of the box. Last but not least, the avatar components. Avatars are everywhere, not only at the movies. Avatars are used to signify, for example, user profiles. With TAdvAvatar, you can create, based on a picture, an avatar quite easily. And even better, if you have multiple avatars and you want to offer a list of them, there is TAdvAvatarList that allows you to create a list of avatars as a collection at design time, for example, and TMS VCL UI controls will do the rest for you to order them according to your parameter settings. Let's get started at looking at TAdvFrameView first. As the name says, frames are at the center of this component. You define a frame that is supposed to be repeated inside of the list. Here, a very simple example. We have a frame defined at design time inside of the RedStudio IDE with a couple of labels, but also, and this is the key aspect, with a spin edit, with a checkbox and a button. And best of all, these controls can have events that are available inside of the list. To make this all work, one essential part is needed. The frame needs to implement an interface, the iAdvFrame interface. And this interface requires you to implement two methods. One is called select, the other one is called unselect. And as the name suggests, you implement there what happens to your frame if the user selects that particular frame in the list, and what happens if the user unselects that particular item in the list. In a nutshell, implement how to show a selection in select and revert those changes that the frame looks like before in unselect. Here's an example. In select, we change the color to CL yellow, and in unselect, we change the color to CL button face. Also, when the button is clicked, we check the checkbox and we change the color of the label to red. Right now, the form is empty, but we can create a frame view based on a number of rows. All in one column, we have a row of this very same frame over and over again. Random data is being used to provide a ranking, but see that the team numbers are ascending. So you have as the identifying factor for your frames an index. So this index is basically presented here, 1, 2, 3, and so on. And if we click, we see that the click event is being implemented. Furthermore, if we go into the column mode, here we have 1, 2, 3 columns with a certain number of rows. The functionality isn't affected, it still works the same way. We can also use a grid where we have a certain number of columns and rows, like so. And the best part, we have responsive design. So right now my form is wide enough, but as soon as I make it smaller, the control will automatically reduce the number of columns and increase the number of rows. All of this is dynamic, as you'll see right now. So when you drop a frame view on your form, the first thing you should inspect are the events. And the most important events are the ones that start with on frame. What happens if one particular frame is created? What happens if one particular frame is destroyed? And then we can also monitor keys being pressed inside of a frame, if a frame is selected and unselected. Those are the key events of this new control. In order to make this easier to see, I implemented, with the help of TMS, the control in code, where you can see that we assigned the events at runtime and not at design time. Furthermore, the different options with regards to column-based, row-based, and grid-based, as well as responsive, can easily be found which properties you have to change. Note, for example, here, if we just want a row-focused design, we just send the number of rows and keep the number of columns to one. With regards to additional number of columns, here we have 3 columns, 50 rows, but we can limit the number of items, for example. Furthermore, here, we have an example for dynamic frame creation with a number of 10 rows, 5 columns, and the item height is being calculated automatically. That's why we initialize it with 0 here. And with regards to the count, we have 75 items in here. And then you might wonder, I specify the number of items, but how does the control actually know which frame to present? Well, that is handled in the frame class property. And the reason why it is advantageous to do this at runtime, apart from, I have to admit, setting the size and all that kind of stuff, some things you have to set at runtime, and that is the frame class. Because frame class, if we drop the control on the form, is not available at design time. So this is where you specify which frame is to be used within the component. And that's more or less it already. Two important events have to be implemented, and in this case, only one, which is the create frame property. The only thing we do is we get handed a new frame that has been created, and this is the key thing to understand, that will be created by the control, not by us. So we do not need to create it or free it. That is the reason why destroy frame is empty. We're not using any particular objects, instances on our frame that has been reserved in create frame, so we don't need to free anything in destroy frame. So key thing to understand here, the create frame is used to initialize the data on the frame that just has been created, and in order to know which frame you're dealing with, you get the frame instance and you get the index of that frame in the component. And of course, as you know, we have two frame, two instances. We can typecast using a frame as tframe2. Obviously, you can do that for your specific frame class just like that. Also, another option is you customize the frame. You add a method to the frame that adds the data to the frame instead of doing it here from the outside. You do it in the frame class itself by handing over the identifying information like the index, for example. And with that, the frame is initialized and it will be shown according to the settings that you set right from the start, rows, columns, item height, and so on. Please look at the product documentation for all the different properties, how you can influence the settings, but this is the key knowledge that you need in order to use the frame view control in your own applications. Let's have a look at TAdvance toggle switch to allow easy switching between Boolean values. This is the default configuration. Drop it on the form. It is configured with very, very common colors for the green color when it is switched on and for the white color if it is switched off. Also, the round definition is the default. And it can be changed really easily. For example, the on property here allows you to switch true, false, and you can see that it goes to the green color if it is switched on. And the shadow can also be removed if you are so inclined. But the greatest feature I think there is with regards to accessibility is that you can also make it rectangular. So you can set rounded to false and you get the more common on the Android platform the rectangular or square visualization for your Boolean values. That's how easy it is to use this control. There is really no further introduction needed. With regards to the advanced string grid, there is a method now inside of the advanced string grid that allows you to add an advanced toggle to a grid cell. Last but not least, let's look at the avatar controls. Let's start with the basic avatar here. You drop it on the form, and the picture property allows you to select a picture, load it from disk or in your code at runtime, of course. I pick paris.png. It's a rectangular image, as you see right here. And there it is. There we have the avatar representation. And I can configure the caption, hashtag Paris. This is not really readable right now, so I set the caption background to a white color. And there we go. We have the avatar display that we're used to from other platforms that use these kind of avatars. If you have the need for multiple avatars, for example, if you write an email or support platform and you have multiple users participating in a thread, you might want to show all their avatars on top of the page. And that can be done with the avatar list. By default, here is the visual representation. And it is a little bit more complicated that we don't just deal with pictures in this case. Instead, TMS decided to create an own custom type in the avatars property. We can get to the designer for the avatars, and we can now add, for example, an avatar one, and the picture is here. For example, let's take Sandra Bullock and add another picture, Julie Andrews, and another one, Kate Blanchett. So we have three avatars right now. And as soon as we click the control again, it's being updated and even shown at design time. Of course, you can specify the distance, the overlap. How much overlap is there supposed to be between them? 50 is the default. I can make it 30 to move them apart a little bit more, or 80 to have more overlap, which doesn't make any sense in my opinion. So 50 is a pretty good value. And of course, you can increase the size. This is the view for the size 50. And that's how easy it is to create lists of avatars. The order is also determined how you order the avatars in this list. So I just changed it, and the design time is updated as well. We hope you like this hands-on view at the new controls in VCL UI Pack 13. If so, please give us a thumbs up, or even better, subscribe to this channel that you won't miss any videos in the future. Stay safe and take care.